Hello students, hope you all are doing well. This pandemic situation has brought a lot of changes and we all are undergoing a stressful situation. Students of classes 10 and 12 must be additionally worried about their upcoming CBSE board examination 2021. Krishnanagar Public School, Nadia, in its humble attempt to be by your side, have come up with special classes by a team of experts. We are thankful to Sting News for extending their welcoming hands. Students, all the best to you. Stay safe, stay blessed.
Hello everyone. A warm welcome to all our viewers. We are here to discuss a very important topic of our class 12 syllabus for economics. And the name of the chapter is called National Income and Related Aggregates. We start with a very basic definition of national income. When we talk about national income, we include money value of all final goods and services produced within the domestic territory of a country during a given period of time, which is usually 1 year. So when we talk about national income, we take the money value of all final goods and services. We need to keep in mind, we are talking about final goods and services, not those goods and services which goes into the making of other goods and services, which are specifically known as intermediate products. So when we talk about national income, we are talking about the money value of all final goods and services. But why money value? Let's take an example. I am a producer and I am producing cotton. So the measurement of cotton will be in bales. Some other producer is there. The producer is producing phone. So the number of phones that he is producing, that will be in pieces. So every good has its own measuring unit. So we cannot say that as a country, I am producing 1 lakh bales of cotton and 10,000 mobiles and 20,000 pen and so on. So for this, we have taken a common unit and that common unit is money. So national income, as we define, is the money value of all final goods and services produced within the domestic territory of a country. Now, when we talk about domestic territory, what do we mean by domestic territory? It means the geographical boundaries within which our country is situated. When we talk about the domestic territory, we are including all international organizations which are outside the physical boundaries of the country, but we are also excluding all those international organizations of other countries which are situated in our geographical area. So when we talk about domestic territory, we talk about the physical boundary of the country or the geographical boundary of the country, including our international offices which are situated outside the country and excluding other international organizations and their offices like embassies of other countries which are situated in our country. So, to sum up, when we talk about national income, it is the money value of all final goods and services produced within the domestic territory of our country in a year. That is very important. Now, when we talk about national income, we need to keep one very important point in mind. We are talking about the money value of all final goods and services. We are not including transfer income or transfer payments. When we talk about transfer income or transfer payments, we are talking about unilateral receipts and payments. That means one-sided receipt or payment which a country normally receives or which a country normally pays. Let's say, for example, donation or gifts which we are giving without contributing anything to current year's productive activities or production. So this transfer payment is also not a part of national income. So when we talk about national income, it is the money value of all final goods and services that we have produced within the domestic territory of our country in a time frame which is normally 1 year. Now with this, we come to a very important topic of the chapter, and that is what is called circular flow of income. We know that usually the entire country is divided into three parts or three sectors. One is the household sector, second is the business, third is the government. But this is a case when we talk about closed economy, when there are just the household, business and the government sector. But when we talk about an open economy, there is another part which is called the fourth part or fourth sector, which is the rest of the world. But as per our syllabus of CBSE, we are only dealing with circular flow of income with two model, and that is what is without savings and investment. So when we talk about circular flow of income, we mean that the money is moving back from one party to another party. Suppose there are two sectors, one is the household and the other one is the business firm or the business sector. The household is assumed to be the owners of factors of production. We know from our previous knowledge that there are four factors of production: land, labor, capital and entrepreneur. So we know that there are four sectors in an economy. One is the household, the other one is the business, the government and the rest of the world. When we consider the first three, we are talking about closed economy, and when we include the rest of the world, we are talking about an open economy where import and export trade is also there. We know that the household is the owner of factors of production. Our previous knowledge says that there are four factors of production. One is land, the other one is labor, capital and entrepreneur, that is the organizer. So these four factors of production is basically owned by the household sector. And the other sector, which is the business sector is basically producing goods and services. Now we are talking about the circular flow, and how is this circular flow taking place? The household is basically providing its services, that is the factor services, in terms of provision for land, labor, capital and entrepreneur to the businessman or the business sector. The business sector, suppose for example, in return is producing the mobile phone. So a tangible product is being produced by the business sector. Now what happens? When these four factors of production, that is the land, labor, capital and entrepreneur, they are giving their services to the business in return is making them a payment, and the payment is called factor payment. The land receives rent, the labor receives wages, the capital is going to receive the interest, and the entrepreneur is going to receive the profit. So all these four factor payment is made by the business sector to the household sector. So the real flow, that is the flow of services, is from the household to the business, and the money flow is from the business to the household. Now with this money, what the business, what the household is going to do? The household is again going to buy that goods and services which the business sector has bought. So it is the money of the business which is again going back to the business, and this is what is called circular flow of income. So one, there is a money flow from the business to the household in terms of factor payments, and then the lower loop of the circular flow says that there is a payment from the household to the business in terms of payment for the goods and services that they are buying. So there are two types of flow. One is the real flow, when services are moving from the household to the business, and the other one is the flow where the actual goods are moving from the business to the household. When we talk about the money flow, again there are two types of money flow. One in terms of factor payments from the business to the household, and other in terms of payment for goods and services from the household to the business. So where, what we are doing, we are making a very great assumption that if the business sector is making a payment of 500 rupees to the household is spending the entire 500 rupees and the money goes back in entirety to the business sector. But many a times it may not happen. People like me, they will start saving. Let's say I received 400 rupees from the business sector and I am buying goods worth rupees 300 from the business sector. So the money that went back to the business is 300. So where is that 100 rupees going? That 100 rupees is basically I am saving. And what will I do with that 100 rupees? I am going to invest that 100 rupees into my bank account. So a very important role is played here by the financial market and the capital market. The capital market is now channelizing this 100 rupee which I have invested there and giving it as a loan to those business sector. So again, there is a circular flow. The money of business sector is moving back to business sector, but in a somewhat other form. But still, it is circular flow, because again, the entire income that the household has generated from the business has gone back to the business. So this was all about two sector model with savings, about the circular flow. Now, there are certain important aggregates that we are going to discuss. The very first aggregate, or the national income aggregate, that comes in our mind is the domestic product. Now, when we talk about domestic product, we are basically meaning the value of all final goods and services produced by the enterprises located within the domestic territory of a country. So when we talk about domestic product, we are basically talking about the money value of all goods and services which are produced within the domestic territory of our country. Now with this, we move on to another topic, and that topic is called national product. So when we talk about national product, it is nothing but it is the final value of all goods and services that are produced by the normal residents of a country in a year, whether operating within the domestic territory of the country or outside. So when we talk about national product, it is not only the geographical concept, we are also emphasizing on being the normal residents. So when we talk about normal residents, we basically mean those person who has got an economic interest in that area. So that person becomes the normal resident of that area. So when we talk about national product, we are talking about the money value of all final goods and services produced by the normal residents of a country within the domestic, operating within the domestic territory of the country or outside. But there is one basic difference between this domestic product and national product. The only difference is called net factor income from abroad. So we are talking about domestic product and national product. As I told you, domestic product is the money value of all final goods and services produced within the domestic territory of a country, usually in a year. And when we talk about national product, it refers to the value of final goods and services produced by the normal residents of a country during a year, whether operating within the domestic territory of the country or outside. Now, if it is asked, what is the difference between domestic product and national product? Mind it, the answer will not be in a tabular form. Here the difference is a simple answer, which is called NFIA, net factor income from abroad. So when we talk about domestic income, we are basically talking about the income within the country. And when we talk about national income, we are talking about the national product. We are talking about all those incomes which is being generated from outside the country and the income that we are giving to others outside our country. And that is why we are using the word net. We are not using the word factor income from abroad. We are using the word net factor income from abroad, which means that the factor income received minus the factor income paid. So what is the difference between DP and NP? The difference between DP, that is domestic product, and NP, that is national product, is NFIA. With this, we move to national product at market price and national product at factor cost. When we talk about market price, we are basically talking about the price at which the product is being sold into the market. That is the sellable value of the product. But when we talk about factor cost, the factor cost is nothing but it is the cost at which the product is being produced. Now, if I ask you what is the difference between the market price and the factor cost, you will tell, sir, the difference between market price and factor cost is the profit. But not exactly. In economics, we know that profit, or normal profit, is already included in the factor cost. That is, the cost of production already includes a very nominal amount of profit which the producer should get in order to carry on with the production activities. So profit is already included in the cost of production or the factor cost. So what is the difference now between the market price and the factor cost? The difference between the market price and factor cost is called NIT, that is net indirect taxes. When we are producing a particular good, let's take an example, I am producing a particular pen and the cost of production of that pen including my profit is 6 rupees, but I am selling that pen at 7 rupees into the market. So why this addition 1 rupee, even if my profit has been included. So the additional 1 rupees is nothing, but it is the tax which the government has imposed. So when I go to the market, or when you go to the stationery shop and you say, I want a pen, will the shopkeeper tell you that the price of the pen is 6 rupees and 1 rupees is the tax of the government? No, he will tell you that the price is 7 rupees. And that is what is the market price, the price at which the product is being sold. So if I ask you, what is the difference between FC and MP? FC means factor cost and MP means the market price. So the difference between FC and MP is NIT, net indirect tax. So when we talk about net indirect tax, we are talking about the indirect tax which the government has levied minus the subsidy, if any, that the government has given to us. And that is why the word net. With this, a very important concept comes, that is called gross product and net product. When we talk about production, we are talking about machines. We are producing goods with the help of certain tangible things. And these machines or tangible things will depreciate over a time period. So when we talk about gross and net, the difference here is called depreciation, or which is better known as consumption of fixed capital. So with this concept of three important concepts of NFIA, that is net factor income from abroad, NIT, that is the net indirect tax, and depreciation, which is better known as consumption of fixed capital, we are moving into certain aggregates which are very, very important in order to measure national income. So the first aggregate that we are talking about is called GDP-MP. That is the gross domestic product at market price. So since we have already known the meaning of domestic product, we already know the meaning of gross, we also know the meaning of market price. So the entire definition stands as GDP-MP is the money value of all final goods and services produced within the domestic territory of a country in a given year. With this, when we move to net domestic product MP, that is NDP-MP, we are talking about the money value of all final goods and services produced by the normal residents of the country within a given year, which is usually 1 year. When we talk about NNP-MP, so it's the same definition which stands, but excluding depreciation, that is consumption of fixed capital. So as I told you, the difference between gross and net is nothing but depreciation, that is consumption of fixed capital. So when we talk about NNP-MP, that is net national product at market price, we are talking about the market value of all final goods and services produced by the normal residents of a country in a year, excluding consumption of fixed capital, which is depreciation. With this, we come to GDP-FC. That is gross domestic product at factor cost. So it is the cost of production, the cost at which the goods have been produced, and it is at the gross value, which includes depreciation. When we talk about GNP-FC, we are talking about the gross value of cost of production, or the gross production cost of goods within a given year, which is usually 1 year, within the domestic territory of a country. When we talk about NDP-FC, we are talking about the factor cost of producing goods by the normal residents. When we talk about domestic product, we are talking about within the country. And when we talk about national product, we are talking about the normal residents. So when we talk about NNP-FC, we are talking about the net value of goods and services which are being produced by the normal residents of a country, usually in 1 year, which is taken as the base. So NNP-FC is known as nothing but our national product. So this NNP-FC, that is net national product at factor cost, is better known as the national income, that is the market value of all final goods and services produced by the normal residents of a country, or by the normal residents of a country in a given year. With this, we move to a very important concept, which is called the national disposable income. It is defined as the sum total of the national income at market price and the current transfers received from the rest of the world. This is very important. See, we are getting into import and export trade. When we are importing, we are making certain payment to other countries, and we are exporting, we are receiving certain factor payments from other countries. So the national disposable income, that is the NDI, it is the market value of all final goods and services produced within the country plus net current transfers received from the rest of the world. With this, we move on to a very important concept, which is called private income. So private income is the total income of the country minus the income which accrues to the government department. So again, I am repeating, when we talk about private income, we are talking about the total income of the country minus the income which is accruing to the government sector. So that becomes the private income. If we deduce from private income, we come to personal income. That is the income of people like us. So private income, from there we come to income of people like us. That is what is personal income. But there are certain amount of taxes that we need to pay to the government. So from our income, that is the personal income, if we reduce or if we subtract the amount of tax that we pay to the government, what is left is called PDI, which is called the personal disposable income. With this, there is a very important concept which is called per capita income. That is the average income of the country. That is the total income of the country or the national income of the country divided by the population. So what we get is called the per capita income. There are two more important aggregates with this. One is called GDP at current prices. We talk about GDP at current prices. It means the money value of all goods and services produced by the enterprises located within the domestic territory of a country. Normally in a year, but which is measured at current level of price or the current market price. That is what is called GDP at current price. But if you remember, we have done a chapter which is called index number in class 11. And there we were measuring the change with respect to a base year. We are measuring the change in national income with reference to a base year even. And that is what is called GDP at constant prices. When we talk about GDP at constant prices, we are talking about the money value of all final goods and services produced by the residents of a country in a year prevailing at the current market price, but with reference to a base year, and that is why it is called constant prices. Till here, we were talking about the national income aggregates. We move on to the last aspect, and the last aspect is called methods of measuring national income. We know that there are three methods of measuring national income. The first method is called the net product method or the value added method. Under the value added method, what we are doing, we are basically measuring the value of final output which is produced by the different sectors of a economy. So what we do in the first step, we are classifying the production units. We are classifying the production units into three. One is the primary sector, which is related to agriculture. Then the secondary sector, and then the third one, which is the tertiary sector. So under the value added method, the first step is called classification of production units into three sectors: primary, secondary, tertiary. In step two, we are adding the value added by each enterprises under primary, secondary and tertiary. Now when we talk about value added, what is it? It is the value of output minus the value of input. Let's take an example. We are producing a steel almirah. So the value of the almirah minus the value of the steel that goes into the making of the almirah, that is what is to be deducted in order to know the value of output. So step two is nothing but it is the addition of all the value added done by all small units and big units under primary, secondary and tertiary. So if we add all this value added, what we get? We get step three, which is called the domestic output that is within the country. Or rather, we can say the market value of all the value added within the country, that is what is domestic output. Step 4, net factor income from abroad. We have to estimate what is the factor income that we have received and paid. And ultimately what we get is called net factor income from abroad. Step 3 plus step 4, that is net factor income from abroad, we'll end up to the answer, and that is what is called national income. So under national income by value added method, we are first under step one categorizing the entire economy into three sectors. One is called the primary, the other one is called the secondary, and the third one is called the tertiary. We add up all the value adds by all the three sectors. What we get is called the domestic product. With that, we add up the NFIA and we get the national income. The second method is called the income method. Now, when we talk about the income method, we are basically adding up all the incomes of all the people who are there. So under step one here, we are going to classify the entire economy into various categories. And the categories are nothing but the small enterprises or the big enterprises. Now we know that there are four factors of production, and these factors of production that is land, labor, capital and entrepreneur. And when they give their factor services, in return they are going to get certain income. And what are the income categories then? The first one, that is for the labor, we get an income which is basically known as wages or salaries, which is basically in a broad sense under economics is known as compensation of employees. We normally say it as COE. For the labor part, that is COE. For the land part or for the capital part taken together, we talk about operating surplus. And people like us, let's take an example, I am a teacher. When you come to me and make certain payment, what happens? Or when we go to a doctor and we make a fee payment to the doctor, can the doctor say that out of the 700 rupees which the doctor has received, 300 is for his knowledge, 400 is for the setup? Obviously no. So such type of incomes where we cannot segregate as compensation of employees or operating surplus, it is called mixed income. So under step 1 of the income method, we are categorizing enterprises. Under step 2, we are categorizing incomes as compensation of employees, operating surplus and mixed income. So when we add all these three, that is the COE, operating surplus and MI, what we get is called the domestic income or the domestic factor income. And as we were doing in the expenditure method also, as we were doing in the output method also, we are going to add the net factor income from abroad and what we get is the national income. So under the second method, that is the income method, we are first categorizing the enterprises, adding up all the incomes by the name of compensation of employees, operating surplus, mixed income, and then we are adding the NFIA and what we get is the national income. I am saying adding because we are assuming that the income is more than the factor payments that we have made to the other countries. But if the NFIA is negative, then we are going to subtract it. The last method of our discussion is the expenditure method. Now let's take an example that there are four people here. I do not know how much money they are earning or how much money they are carrying. But suppose for Mr. X says that I have eaten chocolates for rupees 20, I have bought a book for rupees 500 and I still have 30 rupees with me. So can I estimate his or her income? Obviously. We will add up all the expenditures and we will come to know, okay, this was the income or the money that he was carrying with him or her in his pocket. So under the expenditure method also, we are dividing the entire country into four ways. One is the business sector, the other one is the household, then we have the government, and then we have the rest of the world, as we were discussing in the very beginning today. So there are four sectors. One is the household, then the business, then the government, and then the rest of the world. So these four sectors have their own expenditures. The expenditure of the household is called private final consumption expenditure, PFCE. The expenditure done by the business is known as business investment, that is BI. The expenditure done by the government sector is called government expenditure, which is GE. And the expenditure of the rest of the world is categorized as X minus M, that is export minus import. So under step 1, we are dividing the entire country into 4, that is household, business, government and rest of the world. Under step 2, we are categorizing their expenditures. For household, it is private final consumption expenditure. For business, it is business expenditure or investment. For government, it is government expenditure. And for the rest of the world, it is export minus import. We add these three and what we get is called the domestic income. With this, what we are going to do, we are going to minus, subtract the net indirect tax. That is very important because we are talking about expenditures. That is the money value that we are spending. So everything is being done at the market price. So with that market price, if we subtract the net indirect tax, what we get is called the factor cost. And as usual, we are going to add up the net factor income from abroad and we land up to an answer which is called the national income. So this was all about the expenditure method. Step 1, classification of the entire country or the classification of the economy. Step 2, classification of expenditure, that is private final consumption expenditure, business investment, government expenditure and X minus M. From there we are going to subtract the net indirect taxes so that we come down to the factor cost and we add up to the NFIA, that is the net factor income from abroad, and we land up to an answer which is the national income. So this was all about national income and related aggregates, which is a very, very important topic. Approximately around 10 marks out of the entire question paper from this segment is carried by this chapter. I hope it will make things easier for all of you. Thank you, everyone.